This is NDTV, and you're watching NDTV Profit.
International travel trade show. Organized by Fairfest Media Limited annually, it witnesses huge participation from the tourism fraternity the world over. The highlight of OTM 2014 was the Travel Industry's 100 Most Influential Persons Awards. And the panel discussions which brought to the stage eminent players of the travel industry.
First set of awards are ready. We selected 100 top people in different segments, so let's say about 25, 30 in each segment. These segments were travel agents and tour operators, outbound operators, domestic operators, and so on, you know. And government of representatives were ex officio. You know. So with that disclaimer, let us start.
The Travel Industry's 100 Most Influential Persons Awards recognized and honored industry leaders for their commitment and dedication to the industry. Nominations for the awards were invited from the industry and a list of over 300 nominees emerged. The nominees were asked to poll for one another, and in a separate round, the nominees were polled by thousands of industry players. More than 700 responses were received in time and considered. The 100 most influential persons in the travel trade were selected on the basis of a minimum rating of 0.50 in both the rounds, which means that at least 50% of those who voted for a nominee voted in favor of the winning nominee. Nominations for the most influential persons from national, state tourism organizations and certain other categories were selected ex officio or by the jury. The most influential person awardees were also invited to speak on the panels to speak on important issues. Let's hear them. The summit opened with a discussion focusing on one of the biggest segments of the Indian travel markets, business travel and MICE. Is business travel one of the most lucrative segments of the Indian travel market? That was the question put to the panel of industry experts comprising of Ashwini Kakkar, executive VC, Mercury Travels, Subhash Goyal, chairman, Stick Travels, Arun Hatangadi, COO, Bonten Tours, and Tarun Malhotra, director, Inorbit Tours.
Well, let me start by just giving you an overview of both the business travel market and the MICE market. I think the business travel market last year at the end was about $23 billion just out of India alone. And this includes domestic and international numbers of Indians traveling abroad, Indians traveling within the country. And it has seen double-digit growth, and it will continue to see double-digit growth in the years to come. And it is estimated that by the end of 2018, this market could be as large as a $50 billion market. What is leading this growth? Actually, this growth is being led by the IT and the services sector, but clearly, manufacturing growth and other growth sectors in India are supporting this entire growth. Almost 25% of all travelers who are business travelers take more than 5 trips in a year. That's an amazing statistic. The average Indian business traveler will spend many more hours at work during his business travel than the average business traveler around the world, and will value loyalty programs a hell of a lot. So 90% of Indian business travelers are members of loyalty programs, and they value that loyalty program, and they think it's their right to claim. And as far as MICE is concerned, the situation is slightly different, because in MICE, we are currently at only about $3 billion. So that is a very small number. We are ranked 30th in the world. And so we are very far behind as far as MICE is concerned, meetings, incentives, conferences, and exhibitions. Clearly, this is also growing at a frenetic pace, so we'll probably double over the next 5 years. And the great thing about both business travel and MICE, as far as India is concerned, is that in terms of prices, the prices of the services have been coming down steadily over the last 4 decades, and the service quality aspect has been going up. So every MICE or business travel buyer can hope to see very low prices, but can see very good service quality levels. It's important to have a really trusted partner who can bring insights, not just knowledge, but insights, and take you forward on this journey, whether it's a business travel journey or a MICE journey, in the best possible manner.
You know, total number of inbound tourism into the country last year was about 6.8 million. And total number of outbound travelers was close to 16 million. So our outbound travel is more than double of inbound travel. The result is that the country needs foreign exchange, and billions of dollars are going out and less money is coming in. We are not able to create jobs in India. We are not able to promote India. And it is shameful that we have the world's 75% of the Himalayas are in India, and the beaches, the world's best beaches. Still, we are not a MICE destination. The biggest impediment to business travel and conferences in India is the difficulty to get an Indian visa. It's a Herculean task. Now, with visa being relaxed, with e-visa, I'm sure these business travelers' investment into India will go up. We have a lot of challenges, but we should look at those challenges as opportunities, number one. Number two, India is a democratic country. We have to take care of public opinion. We are not China, where, you know, it is do or die, nor are we Singapore, a city-state. We are a world's largest democracy, and every state has its own problems. But we should not give up. Biggest challenge we have is overtaxation. The government looks at it, you know, there is a multiplicity of taxes. There is a luxury tax, and then this luxury tax varies from state to state. The foreign tourist is worried. Somewhere it's 15%, somewhere it's 20%. Then there is a service tax. And plus there is road tax, there is tax on tax. So with the result that the Indian tourism product is becoming prohibitive. If we reduce these taxes and the government looks, finally the government has started looking on visa on arrival, and now we want the government to look at this industry as an industry which creates jobs. One out of every 9 jobs that are going to be created in the next 20 years will be in this industry, because it's highly labor intensive. Agriculture is mechanized. There are no more jobs left in the agriculture. So the government has to focus on this, because we still have 350 million people below poverty line.
This is NDTV, and you're watching NDTV Profit.
The well-debated and discussed topic on business travel was followed by a session on the future of travel agents and online travel agents in the Indian travel space. Renowned faces from the segment took to the stage for a dialogue on the survival strategies of travel agents as airlines go direct to consumers, thereby squeezing their commissions. The key speakers included Jyoti Mayal, Director, New Airways Travel; Ankush Nihchavan, MD, Travel Boutique Online; Faisal Siddiqui, Director, Zaka Group; Vishwanath Chatterjee, Director, EasyRest Travel Technologies; and Parni Murugesan, MD, Pioneer Aero Travels.
If the airline cutting commission is a threat to a travel agent, I personally believe it isn't, for a simple reason. If you see the Western markets and the developed countries today, if you speak to a lot of travel agents there, they actually make more money today without the commissions. It's going to be a boon for the travel agent that one could able to charge what he wishes to depending on the services they're going to offer. Secondly, is the airline going direct to the customer? Is it a threat? Yes, no. For a simple reason, I think the sheer convenience today for a customer to talk to a travel agent or an OTA is much more than actually talking to an airline. There are challenges when it comes to a lot of service deliveries at the airline call centers. I personally believe a lot of airlines' websites are not as effective today as the large OTAs. Secondly, the credit card gateways is something which I still believe in India take a lot of time because a lot of people still don't have limits for them to buy their travel products and needs. The parallel economy is here to stay for some time, and I believe if still these challenges are not solved, the airlines will not gain their share on directly publicizing their fares on the website. Getting online is very important. The simple demographics of India today, if you actually look into this, 130 million users are there on the internet. 65 of them are actually on smartphones now. Every youngster between 80 and 40 wants to go on the app to look for the travel products. Also count to the product, somebody who has the content will be a winner. People at my age or much younger actually like to see what they want to buy. So therefore, to go online is very, very important. It is very important for somebody, whether he's a traditional travel agent, to become online. Otherwise, yes, the large OTAs will definitely take the share away. And that, I think that's a bigger threat to a traditional travel agent more than the airline going direct.
Well, everyone knows the travel industry is going through a change. It's evolving. We are turning towards the mature markets. We are growing. And of course, it's like a butterfly going through its metamorphosis. We were in the larva stage, now we are in the cocoon stage, I think. Until the time we don't become a butterfly, I think there are going to be a lot of changes which are going to keep happening. Well, airlines are trying to push us into one corner, so we really don't know how we are going to react to them. We are trying by doing different things. Wherever the markets have matured, we have seen the airlines have taken over as the website sellers. In the mature markets, the OTA, they are blocking the OTAs. So the OTAs also have to change. OTAs are not going to only be a brand. They have to be a platform too, to sell all the airlines. And the main thing that matters to them, that they have to give service and the best competitive rate. I think that's what really matters in the end, because the airlines are also blocking the sites so that they could sell directly. The travel agents, the OTAs, and the traditional agents are here to stay. They have to, of course, better their strategies, better their services, get on a broader platform, create niche markets, and sell non-air products, and move forward till the time there's a dual economy in our country.
Unique problems and prospects of promoting outbound from India was one of the most important topics that took the spotlight at the National Tourism Summit at OTM. Sunila Patil, Director, Veena World; Rajiv Bagle, MD, Kioni Travel; Anju Tandon, Director, Arc Travels; and Gopi R. Lenga, Consultant to UI, were the eminent voices addressing the concern of service tax as a concern facing the industry.
The basis of service tax is you pay tax on the services that are rendered, and if as a country you are putting a tax on a service that is rendered, then I think it must be rendered in your country. The only service we are rendering is making the arrangements, but the actual services in which are being rendered are in a foreign country. So you do end up paying it twice in a way, and I think that is totally unjust and totally unfair.
Just talking of the foreign exchange, I think just briefly, all of you would know that sometime in August, India had, you know, the currency which was really bouncing. I mean, it fell something like 13% in a month. Not from 91 did it fall to that extent. As tour operators, we were confronted with a very difficult situation where customers were confused. They just stopped booking. And although we later on made up our, you know, figures that we targeted in September, we actually completely lost the shortfall of August as lost for the year. So just to understand consumer behavior when volatile rupee faces them, and of course we had a number of customers saying that, look, we paid you at a particular rate, and you know, especially our MICE customers. So yes, we did take a hit. It proved one thing, and we became far more agile on it now, that we will not allow volatility of the currency to affect our pricing. So long as we are in this underdeveloped market, we will continue to pay for the, you know, the taper. What is this taper? They used to pump a lot of money, the US, and now, let's say, for their own sovereign interest, they are reducing that taper. but it's causing havoc in the under, you know, in the BRICS and in this, let me call it fragile five. Now, one way to look at it is for USA to tell us that, look, it's your economy, you didn't manage it, you ran a current account deficit, you couldn't survive, you ran a fiscal deficit, you couldn't survive. Why blame us if we are looking at our economy, which incidentally is the biggest in the world? True, but I'm just saying that I think countries have to be very mindful of what steps each one takes and what effect it has on the others. So the quick reaction to this is, yes, CAD seems to be in control. So we are not looking at something as harsh as saying we are not going to allow BTQ limits, which are very decent today, to come down. But the government has cut down dramatically the amount of money available for foreign investments. The government cut down, and I think now has relaxed, monies that were available to corporates to invest overseas. There was an automatic provision that you can do some four times more. So I have a feeling that because it will affect too many people, nothing happened on the BTQ part, and I'm thankful for that, because our industry would survive, you know, only for the fact that BTQ is allowed. But if the current account deficit were to worsen, I wouldn't rule it out. On service tax, up to July 12, we were not having a tax because the service was rendered outside India. It was falling within the export of services rules. So there was no reason for it to be taxed. And when the exemption went off, we were told we are getting an abatement of 75%, but 3.09%. It's crazy. It's bumped up the cost of the entire travel package.
Finally, the National Tourism Summit came to a successful close, with national and state tourism organizations discussing and sharing their views and experiences. Ionis E. Raptakis, Ambassador of Greece. Vipul Mitra, Principal Secretary, Tourism, Devastan Management, Pilgrimation and Civil Aviation, Government of Gujarat. Manoharan Periyaswamy, Director, Tourism Malaysia. Dr. Adil Masri, Director, Egyptian Tourism Office. Raymond Glenn Augustine, India Head, Department of Tourism, Philippines. And Lee Kianghua, Deputy Director, China National Tourism Office, generously shared insights on the topic.
I think the best way the governments can promote and help tourism is by staying off the areas where government should not be there. And that is what we try to do in Gujarat. Because, I would say the government which tries to help too much and get into areas where it should not be, creates more problems. Having said that, we should first delineate and identify what are the areas where government should be very actively involved. 4 years before this, Gujarat was nowhere on the tourism plane or horizon anywhere in the country. It was known as a prosperous state with a lot of industries, with Narmada agriculture coming up, but tourism was not really something we really thought in terms of promoting, because it was not necessity. Unlike many other states like Goa, Pondicherry, maybe Rajasthan, where there's nothing else other than tourism, I think government should come in where private sector does not come in or cannot come in. For example, promotion of destination. No group, however big the group is, would promote a destination. It could promote its own hotel. But even Oberoi or Taj will not promote a particular location. For example, they will not promote Udaipur as a place. So government should promote a destination aggressively, because that is where private sector will not come in.
It's like a difficult climb when it comes to visa. We at the Department of Tourism continue to promote the country so that Indian travelers may come in. There are government agencies, other government agencies we have to liaise with. And this is where the difficulty comes. Some of them are resistant to the goals of the department. So what we do is to continuously update them, provide them additional information, perhaps help them out in whatever. For example, if they need machines or computers that can scan, we endorse this to the national government so that this particular government agency like the immigration may have them. So it is a two-way street. I should say. We have to help them realize our goals, and we also have to help them understand, and then later on even help them out in their other issues.
We have done a lot of work to promote China tourism in India. It's a great challenge how to project the image, the tourism products of China. It's a big challenge. You know, in India, also in China, the media always full of some negative reports. So how can we attract the travelers from India to China? We have to think out good plans. Then we must carry out the good plans and take part in many travel exhibitions and publish, release some media advertisements, and also invite many travel agents and media journalists to China. So first, I want them to understand China correctly, so they will have a strong interest to know more about China, to travel to China. So it's a big challenge, but luckily, they've given me good support. Year after year, the number traveling to China are increasing a lot. You know, last year, almost 700,000 Indian visits to China. It's a big number, increased almost 11% than 2012. But for the most countries, like America, European countries, the tourists to China decreased more than 5%, even 10%. The number one country generating tourists to China is Vietnam. The second is India. So I'm very grateful for your support to India.
We adapt a new marketing strategy according also our new situation in Egypt. So we try to manage the situation beginning of 2010 and the beginning of the revolution 2025 So we manage our situation through four axes. First axis, it was with our partner tour operator. Second axis, it was with the media. Third, it was with the airlines company. Number four, it was with the official channel. For the second point, for the media, whether there are public or private trade magazine, so we increased also our budget for advertising through the magazine and the newspaper. For the third point, for the airlines company, of course, still our national company, Egypt Air, it's first company, and it will still. But also we can, I can say also, we support also now other companies. It means India for us, it's really our future market, and it's a promising market, and we're planning also to spend more and more money in Indian market.
This is NDTV, and you're watching NDTV Profit.